is a good man. Oh, that's a great guess. Great guess. So he is a good man. Try this microphone. See if it works. Nope. So he was a good man. Thank you, Georgina. What about you, Charlie? Do you know anything about this guy? So you didn't know anything about this story? You want to try? Okay, maybe not. So, what do you have?
I know that he served lots of people and helped them. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, great. I'm going to ask people in the congregation, what do we know about St. Francis? Feel free to raise your hand, and I'm just going to point to you so we can hear you. What do we know about St. Francis? We're celebrating Francis Day today, and we have all our animals and kids. But what else do we know, or what more do we know of Francis? Anybody can help these two out? Serena's got something, Anne's got something. I'm coming back to you, Joe.
Gave up earthly possessions.
Gave up earthly possessions. Oh, I mean, it's so dramatic, though. Like, his father owned it. He was a merchant who owned it, lots of cloth, right? So, I mean, like, a designer or somebody with a lot of money, right? And he, like, it's so poetic. Forget that! I don't want any of it! Right? Kind of his home, discards all of the riches and just throws it all back into his parents' face. I don't recommend that for you all, to do that to your parents. I don't. And did you have something to add? Was he a soldier, anybody? Can anyone verify that? I get confused with Ignatius sometimes. I know Ignatius was a soldier. Was he a soldier? I'm not sure if he was, but that, I like that. I'm going to be curious about that. I do know that he was a rich guy who loved rich things. Loved food, company, all of the things. And had a moment where he decided something different for his life. And so for many of our saints, they become kind of icons for us, not just the writing of the story of the icon, but they become this story, this picture. Just close your eyes for a second. Imagine, what picture of Francis do you actually have in your mind? Does he kind of have a bird somewhere near him? Right? Maybe a wolf. There's a story about him and a wolf and appeasing the town of Gubbio, right? A lot of times our saints can be plastered in this one-dimensional sense, which is why I just wanted to ask you what you knew about Francis. But you had something else. What do you have?
He helped the sick.
Oh, he did help the sick. That is a great segue, Charlie. We are going to read the story. Thank you, David. Our audio guy. Give it up for David. Thank you, David. Okay, so it seems as though, everyone, the community that we're hoping can help you to grow in your own faith. We know a few things,
and we're still open to learning lots more about the holy people that are in our church story, right?
So, we have... Okay, so we have a story. Please excuse more stories, but in lieu of a second lesson, thought I'd read a story. There once was a man named Francis. He was born a long time ago in Assisi, Italy, around 1181. His father sold beautiful and expensive clothes and had lots of money to buy Francis anything he could ever want. Sound familiar, anybody? I can Amazon anything right now. Francis wore fancy clothes, and he went to big extravagant parties where there were long tables of delicious food and drink. Make you hungry? Everyone danced and laughed all night without a care in the world. But not everyone lived like Francis. In Francis's town, there were people called lepers. Have you all ever heard of lepers? No? Haven't heard of lepers? point, they would literally go the opposite direction. Absolutely no one touched a lever. Did anyone touch a lever? Nope, no one touched a lever. One day, Francis was riding down the road and he saw a lever. So what do you think he did? He turned around. He definitely turned around. He was terrified of getting the disease. So he quickly turned to go the opposite direction. But here's where the story gets interesting, everyone. This is the story before he did all his marvelous things that he is known for. This is the story of the moment where he turned. Something stopped Francis. What do you think it was? Do you ever feel bad if you see somebody that you can't help? I know I do. Maybe he felt bad. What do you think? Why did he stop?
Maybe his mind stopped him.
Maybe his mind stopped him. Right? Maybe, I don't know if some of your teachers or your family has spoken to you about morals and values. Maybe there's something inside of him that just got him to pause. I wonder. So, but as he turned, something stopped him. Francis remembered the story of Jesus healing a leper in the Bible. And he knew that he couldn't just walk away. Francis felt compassion for this leper who had not been touched in years. He imagined what it would be like to have no one to hug you when you are sad, or pat your back when you are sick, or shake your hand to say hello, and he knew he could not simply walk away. Can you all imagine that? What would it feel like?
Yeah, to be like someone who
was ever touched or said hello to or acknowledged.
That would be really sad.
So if you were to go to school tomorrow and no one said hello to you, what would you do?
Run away. Francis would do, right?
memory cards, memorial cards even, or even the statue that we have in our columbarium and meditation space. Before all of that, Francis, does the Francis who had this moment of conversion speak to you today? Because for me, I could have done a very simple, like, oh, who's Francis today? And, you know, a very easy sermon, I had it in the bag, and then I was like, oh, gosh, how is this connected to the gospel? Come to me, all you who are weary, for you will find rest. Why is that the appointed gospel for the feast day of St. Francis? So I've been wondering all week. And darn it, that friggin' little bird on his shoulder. Has anyone ever had a bird just perch on their shoulder? Has anyone? Chris, of course, Chris. I could have told you that. Chris. Anyone in the choir just have a bird ever perch on you? Oh, and Barb. Oh, sweet Barb. Of course. Now, how was that for you? What happened?
I just always look for the person that's kind of the moment. Like I can remember my daughter in second grade, a student came from Japan, knew not one word of English. Imagine how scared for a kid. Where's the bathroom? You know what I mean? That's not an important thing. Hello, how are you? And I made up cards for my daughter to try to learn a couple words in Japanese just so that this boy would be included.
Thanks, Chris. Chris went to the metaphor already. Right, I was looking for the bird story, but you did go to the metaphor that I'm getting to, that when we are most still, when we are the most spacious, we can receive somebody else's pain or the gentleness of a bird just wanting to find some place to land, or the gentle touch of our pets, or a simple hello and a wave of Winslow, I'm standing in the line, in your line, right here, Yona. We can receive and we can be that place for somebody. But if we're too amped up and our heart is racing too much, there will be no place for the other. It made me wonder about, obviously, St. Paul's in this particular time when people had retired and left, and it opened up a moment for our own discernment. And next Saturday, we are celebrating a new, fresh way. So we were really grateful for, again, this moment and this moment, but the moment that we live through, kind of like a person was born, a person died, and that hyphen. Like, what happened? How did we get here? It's a moment for us to really, truly think, reflect, but also with Francis's invitation to wonder about all of our interconnectedness. That brother sun and sister moon and sister water are literally our family. And that we cannot be separate from all of creation. In fact, we are one of the many created beings. I can't help but the invitation from Francis is, one of my favorite statues is actually this hermitage in Assisi, and it's not a stand-up tall erect with a bird on his shoulder. He's actually laying down, and he's like this. And he's staring up at the sky. He's looking up at the sky, at the stars, and just imagining and dreaming. And I think of a story, how something stopped him. What has stopped you in the last few years? He remembered a Bible story. What Bible story or memory or poem or something just spoke to you, got you to move into your compassion, got you to imagine yourself and your community in a different way? That's what happened to Francis before he became the saint, one-dimensional saint for us. His true conversion, which is what we're all invited to, led him to be a friend to the leper and to do the things that perhaps, now we say, are totally radical
but were just what was needed in the moment.